Fam, you're about to hear something weird, but it's also completely true. So embrace the cringe for a second and bear with me. Human beings are freaking weirdos. If there's any form of awesome media or story that really touches our hearts, depending on how touched we were, we integrate that media into our lives. And even after the narrative of this fictional universe has ended to us, if you can still somehow keep it living on, whether we view ourselves as the main character, or we view this world blossom further in our minds, and occasionally put onto paper, we can continue the existence of a dead universe. It's weird. Makes no sense that we like to do this. There's no way our fan altercations to the story can be objectively good in comparison to the story itself, that it could be called a rightful sequel. Well, maybe to the imaginer, the imagination is badass. But once that imagination is shared with others, it just will not necessarily get across the same message you felt. This video is sponsored by Granado Espada, an RPG that's been consistently evolving since its release in 2006. And if its longevity doesn't tell you about its quality, honestly, I don't know what could. It includes a unique control system where you can control three characters at the same time, making combos never quite as appealing. And oh, don't think anything becomes predictable here. Oh no, quite to the contrary, in fact, because you could choose from 190 characters. Yeah, player versus player, player versus environment, it's all there, where you can develop your own unique style of playing. Speaking of playing, you know how farming is sometimes annoying? And you know how you can't really play most games when you're AFK? Well, this one auto farms when you're AFK! Honestly, for me, that was potentially the biggest hook. It has medieval European graphics, it has over 200 songs in its soundtrack, it's free to play, and its link is in the description. Enjoy! Anything that's internalized is to some degree altered to fit our unique perception of the tale we're allegedly evolving. So a fan fiction develops on the point of the universe that affected me most, or events that I would have wanted to transpire. I personally find fan fictions that ship characters that the narrative is clearly pushing away from each other towards other characters to be extremely irritating. Shipping altogether is somewhat irritating to that degree. It's your personal mentality being imposed upon others, and that's really what most fan fiction is. It's the personal takeaways. It's adding a new overpowered character to the universe that happens to have the same name as the person who wrote the fan fiction. What a coincidence! And since I was not planning on making this video super long or super in-depth, that's my take on the basic psychology behind why the vast majority of fanfics are cringe disaster holes. Obviously, whoever came up with it somehow thought this thing had some semblance of a good idea. But in reality, these are like the most painful things ever. That being said, please stop shipping Bakugo with Buzz Lightyear. It's not a thing. I beg of you. A while back, I wondered to myself why all fanfictions and fan interpretations generally piss me off and are generally just really bad, and unanimously thought of as bad. So this was the basic psychology I came up with as someone with a rather active imagination myself. I generally only like making videos I'm passionate about, so I never got around to doing something like
the psychology behind why all fanfics are dumpster fires.
Yes, it made my clickbait boner stand up a bit, but I just didn't have the passion to make it a full-fledged project. I am, however, passionate about one certain fan sequel, birthed on our very own YouTube. And I personally am a huge fan of this little series. Since I assume many of you may not have watched it, this video isn't necessarily a full-fledged analysis on the narrative of the fan story. Rather, it's the aspects of this fan story that's used in perfecting what fanfics should be. I've said it before many times, and I'll say it as many times as I need to. The currently inactive toxic fanbase aside, I am not embarrassed to say Undertale is basically one of my favorite things ever. In case it wasn't clear by my really in-depth sans analysis that honestly went maybe too in-depth. Link in the description. And the fan-made sequel Glitch Tale by Camila Cuevas, I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name, link is in the description, is not only my favorite fan sequel I have ever seen, by far, but it also taught me an extraordinary amount on how to do fanfics right. An answer to something that honestly really bugged me for the longest of time. I'm sorry for psychoanalyzing your series, Camila. It's good, it's good. Before continuing, shoehorning in a little funny tidbit of information, I posted the thumbnail of this video on Twitter a little while while ago, mentioning that I was interested in doing a video like this just because of how much I like Glitch Tale and converting it into a topic that really anyone with internet access can appreciate. And the old thumbnail was, why all fan stories suck except one, where I would be talking about Glitch Tale. And Camellia herself,
I think Camellia's a girl,
said, well, I don't know about except one. There are a lot of other really good ones. And then she proceeded to send me links to a bunch of other good fanfics. I have gone through a good number of the ones that she sent, and no, in my personal opinion, none of them were as good as Glitch Tale. Not that they were bad by any standards, but I'm just mentioning this to show how, aside from creating a great series, I don't know how many YouTubers would honestly do that. So shout out to be a great freaking person too. That and you were right, and I shouldn't have titled it that way, and it was insensitive of me. For any other fan fiction writers to see it, I apologize. I changed it to why all fan stories suck except oh so few. Yeah, I think that's better, actually. Maybe not on the clickbait side, but that's not all that really matters. But in any case, there were three aspects to Glitch Tale that, in my opinion, made it a near-perfect fanfic. And while there may be takeaway reasonings for anyone, because that's how anyone interprets a story, I'm glad, at least for me, the question that's been plaguing humanity since Hieroglyphics has finally reached some sort of clarity in my mind. And while these three reasons are so simple and so obvious, kinda hurts me that I didn't realize them sooner. But again, it plays funnily into the hands of one of my favorite lines that I've said before, simplicity is the hardest thing to master. Firstly, the power of love. Yeah, I'm sure everyone wants to hear what I have to say now. Psychologically, one of the issues that fanfics in general have is the fact that stories affect everyone differently. So when writing a fan addendum to a tale, it's obviously coming from the psychological state the story left the fanfic writer in. Since all fiction is a form of art, which by definition affects everyone differently, it will make the fanfic suck for anyone who was affected by said story differently than the writer. Fun fact! Same basic psychology applies to why most non-canon character ships are cancerous cringe fests. But that being said, you can't write a fanfic on a source material if you aren't passionate about it, because that would be terrible for the opposite reason, which is why basically all the videos on my channel are on something I am relatively passionate about. But the thing Glitch Tale does to stand out in this case, though, is Camellia obviously loves Undertale, because Glitch Tale is nuanced to even its core narrative with foreshadowing and everything, but just loves Undertale for what it is, and obviously everything about it. So if that's the case, funnily enough, it kind of avoids the psychological issue on how the story affected her differently than everyone else. But since obviously any piece of art does inherently affect people differently to the subconscious level, it's not so simple to just love the official series in its entirety and whoop, we avoided the fanfic problem. Time to crank out some Shakespeare. If it were that easy, we'd have a lot more decent ones than we do. But Camellia took one other completely fascinating step that I think really helped Glitch Tale to its core, and that, fam, is Glitch Tale Season 1. So, no offense, Camellia, but Glitch Tale Season 1 wasn't per se amazing. It was fun and enjoyable to see an alternate take and slightly different interpretation to the lore of Undertale that we knew and loved, and that interpretation wasn't one that would necessarily normally be taken. But in all, I would not be making this video if Season 1 was a standalone. The beauty of Glitch Tale Season 1 is whether consciously or otherwise, it prepped everyone for Season 2 psychologically. For example, I know that before I started working on this video, I barely remembered Glitch Tale Season 1 since I've seen it so long ago, even though I was fully invested in everything about Season 2. Season 1 consisted of several 5 to 10 minute long videos. Season 2 is so far 6 episodes, ranging from 20 to 40 minutes, where some of those episodes are broken into 2 parts. But while Glitch Tale Season 1 was more action-based than narrative-based, it edged the viewers into Camellia's psychological outlook of Undertale, making Season 2 borderline perfection to everyone that's watching it. In simpler words, Part 1 solves the psychology problem behind fanfics, which honestly is probably the most prevalent issue with the whole freaking medium. But it only gets better. And I can segue into the second reason nicely, because I just briefly mentioned how Glitch Tale Season 1 was primarily action scenes, which, psychology or not, are fun to watch. We can have a good time watching it, we can get in tuned with Camellia's psychological outlook of Undertale, and therefore, Glitch Tale Season 2 can be excellence. But my second of the three reasons why Glitch Tale Season 2 is borderline perfection comes from the fact that it is not all fight scenes. I mean, from a story perspective, obviously it can't all be fighting, and that seems obvious, but it's more than that. Most fanfics are a fight scene, a sex scene. It's a war. A focus is on that cool part of the story rather than what actually makes the story great. The latest installment in Glitch Tale Season 2 did not have a single fight in it, but instead it was all there for what? World building and character development in a fanfic? Who'd have thunk? But yeah, it's so crucial. A fan sequel cannot rely solely on the source material, or it doesn't bring anything new to the table. Glitch Tale treats Undertale as a foundation to this new story, not the ingredients of this alternate story. It's evolved from Undertale, and unlike most fanfics that feel like a filler arc of the main story, Glitch Tale feels like an actual sequel to the main story, with the Undyne versus Betty fight, one of my favorite fights ever. And I'm not talking about fan-made fights here, no, not at all. It's definitely my favorite of those. I mean, I read a lot of manga, I watch a lot of anime, and if I talk about all those fights, then this one in Glitch Tale would probably be in my top 25 ever. And no, not because of the epic animation. While the animation was nice, it was great to see these characters back in battle. The philosophical narrative that these characters possessed in the original story were amplified 100-fold for this fight. Everything that made the Undyne fight in Undertale's genocide route amazing made this fight amazing. So, without changing the actual Undertale narrative at all, this is a completely fitting sequel, not afraid to throw wrenches into what you thought you formerly understood, adding societal issues and racism themes as well that did not exist in the original stories for reasons that I will not be spoiling. A lot of what we have is alternate lore interpretation, which is a brilliant way to weave the tale of the future instead of making up a bunch of whole new rules. But the way the original Undertale game was set up was that it's not gonna answer every little question. It will lead you towards answers, it may imply answers to different mysteries, and Glitch Tale Season 2 plays with those implications and twists them to a point that could fit, and that since Glitch Tale Season 2 is so perfect, it does fit. And reason 3 is, it doesn't only work as a sequel, but it builds on the themes and philosophy of Undertale as well. The theme of making friends in Undertale evolved into Glitch Tale maintaining friendships, the lengths gone to do so, as well as dealing with losing friends. In Undertale, a theme was to not let your inner demon taint you, whereas Glitch Tale deals with the themes of harnessing the power and using your inner demon to your advantage, as well as accepting it. So on and so forth, but the basic three reasons summary is 1. Unrequited love of the source material, as well as edging the viewers into Camellia's psychological take of the story. 2. It's treated like an official sequel would be treated, not just the cool parts. 3. It evolves the core philosophy and themes of the original. BAM! You got yourself an amazing fan sequel. Thank you, Camellia, for letting me do this. I'm a huge fan. Her channel link is in the description, but the three takeaway messages of this video is 1. How to write a fanfic. 2. Go play Undertale if you haven't yet. And 3. If you have played Undertale, go check out Glitch Tale. Thanks for watching. I know it wasn't a normal anime-based video of mine, but I was interested in the topic and I figured a psychological evaluation of it all would be fun, and it was! If you want more random topic stuff, feel free to subscribe, leave a like if you enjoyed, and let me know in the comments. Link to my Twitter, Patreon, and merch in the description. See you next time, and remember to stay weird, fam.